And so if I knew what I knew today, how to advocate for myself, I would have advocated for myself back then, but I didn't know how to do that.
Hey, fellow workers. My name's Kim Siever. Welcome back to another episode of the Alberta Worker Podcast. You are tuning in to episode 6 of season 3. We are a proud member of the Labour Radio Network, as well as member of the Harbinger Media Network. We're broadcasting from the territory of the Niitsitapi. Today's guest is Chris Rowley. Welcome, Chris.
Thank you.
All right. So yeah, we're just going to go straight into letting you tell us your life story. So just share with us, you know, where you grew up, what your family life was like growing up, where you went to school, that sort of thing. And then as well, tell us your personal labor history, what your first job was, subsequent jobs, what you're up to now, you know, the journey you took to get there. And you can either do those separately or integrate them together. The floor is yours.
I grew up in a small Mormon family, and I graduated from Okotoks Composite High School. And my first job after high school was a catering at Spruce Meadows, so Great Events Catering. I was asked 3 questions, got hired for the summer, so it was seasonal work. I really enjoyed that work and really had fun with that.
What were you doing for them?
Catering, so like helping with the food at Spruce Meadows.
Okay, like prepping the food and stuff?
Yeah, prepping food, doing the concessions and stuff for them. It was really good. And I guess for me, I really struggled with that job being the first one and not having a lot of security in myself. I was getting promoted within the job. They wanted me to do cash and do more for them. And I was too afraid, didn't know what I was doing. And so I kind of just said, no, I'd rather stay where I am, dishwashing and prepping food and stuff like that.
Okay.
For me, it was like losing out on some opportunities because I never really learned cash skills in high school or anything like that. So
right.
It was a good opportunity, but it's not one that I kept for very long because I was scared to really progress in that. And so after that, I ended up moving back to Lethbridge area and got diagnosed with depression and anxiety.
Okay.
With that came navigating the system of being unemployed and getting on AISH and that kind of stuff. So it was a real rough time for me because even within that time, I was self-harming and stuff and really not taking care of myself. And I was very lucky to have some good friends in Raymond that helped support me through that and really helped me.
Awesome.
So with that, I had some odd jobs here and there in Raymond, working the food industry again, fast food a little bit and stuff. Didn't stay very long at that job because they wanted me to come in after having all 4 wisdom teeth pulled out and on T3s. So I didn't stay very long at that job.
Oh my goodness. Is that Burger Baron?
Yes, that was Burger Baron.
How did I know?
So it was one of those, this is the way they're going to treat me. I don't think I want to stay there very long. And so after that, I kind of moved back into Lethbridge, was kind of just being on AISH for a while. And more recently, I've taken jobs with a junk company, Colley's Junket and Removal.
Oh.
That was a really good job because it was more, I didn't have to think about things. I just worked with him directly and stuff. And I didn't stay at that job because I didn't really have a driver's license and he needed more people with driver's licenses so they could do the work without him there. Yeah, so that job was awesome. Again, I've had all these really awesome jobs, but certain things that I haven't progressed in getting, like a driver's license or things, kind of stopped me from being able to progress in those jobs. And then the more recent job that I had was Telegraph Tap House.
Oh.
It was a really good job, but then the business owners sold it to somebody new and they disclosed my disability without asking.
Really?
It made it really awkward to work under the new owner. And so I quit because I'm like, I don't want him to feel he has to keep me just because I have a disability.
Right.
And so I chose to quit and he did offer me a job back afterwards.
Oh, okay.
I could have gone back and worked for him, but I chose not to. And so now I'm trying to make my public speaking more of a paid job for disability issues and stuff. So I'm looking at doing that more. And one of my big dreams is to get paid to go over to Australia and bring back what they're doing for disabilities and get paid to do that and work in that field. Yeah. So that's just kind of a brief history of some of the work history there.
Cool. And have you done any paid speaking yet?
Yes, I have. I actually was doing some this last weekend in Lacombe and Lethbridge here on what People First of Alberta is. And so that's an organization that advocates for the rights of people with intellectual disabilities. And they've helped me grow in my skills and who I am and really helped me look at that. And we have a saying, fair work for fair pay. And so part of that is making sure that we aren't allowing sheltered workshops to take advantage of people with intellectual disabilities and not pay them for the work they do.
Sure, sure. And what did your parents do while you were growing up?
So my mom was a stay-at-home mom and she had depression. So that's where I got mine from, bipolar. My dad worked as a tradesman in drywalling and stuff.
Oh, mine too.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. Okay. So did you say you have bipolar or you and your mom have bipolar?
My mom has bipolar. I just have, I don't even know what type of depression it is.
Okay.
It's something I have to figure out exactly what type of depression. I think it's more the anxiety piece to it.
All right.
So when people see me speak or just get to know me, it's kind of odd because they're like, you don't have a disability. You don't look like you have one. And so it's one of those where it's more of the learning disability and the anxiety and depression that goes with it. Growing up, my mom was told it was a 50-50 of me and my brother getting the depression as well. So, and it took me coming back to Raymond to get diagnosed because a therapist up in Okotoks said it was all in my mom's mind.
Really?
She caught me on a good day talking about the depression. So she didn't see it over the span of a longer period.
Right.
Yeah. So it was one of those real struggles for me in high school of not having that support with that.
Sure.
Coming back to Raymond, the doctor that I grew up with took me on as a patient again and helped me figure all that out and stuff. So.
Right. Yeah, it reminds me of when our youngest, who's just about 9, we tried to get her diagnosed with ADHD. And the psychologist she was meeting with gave her some paper and some crayons to draw with. And so the whole time that they were meeting with, she just focused on this drawing. And then after they're done their session, she has me come in so she could chat with me. And she tells me, yeah, it was fine. She didn't seem to have any problems focusing, was able to answer all the questions. It's like, yeah, because you gave her a task to focus on.
Exactly.
If she hadn't had that coloring, she would have been up and moving around in her chair and looking out the window and touching stuff and standing up. But because she had something specific to focus on, right? Just going back to your comment about just seeing you for that one split second, you not being able to diagnose you properly.
Exactly.
We had to get a second opinion later on. And of course she had it.
Exactly. And I think within our system of supports or non-supports, it's not always about the diagnosis, but how to deal with the issues that come with trying to live in a society that doesn't allow us to be different. So growing up in church, I was always allowed to doodle and draw and color. And people told my mom she was a bad person for letting me do that in church.
Oh my goodness.
It's like, but that's when I can concentrate the best. Like even in meetings, like I'll be doodling so I can listen and better concentrate on what's being said. And so I look at society putting roadblocks in people's ways by trying to make everyone conform to a certain way of being.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And I found it interesting that comment you said about some people being surprised when you say that you have a disability, because sometimes I have to use a wheelchair. Like if I'm going to be on my feet for long periods or have to go walking long distances, almost every time I have somebody I know come up to me and is like, oh, I didn't know you were in a wheelchair. It's like, it's because my disability, you don't see all the time because it's on the inside.
Exactly. And there's a lot of YouTubers out there that'll talk about that, how it's an aid. It's not something I have to use all the time. It depends on when.
Right.
And so when we need these accommodations for our disability, it really sucks when we ask for it. Like in high school, I asked for accommodations. I got it. And the teacher that was teaching me regular grade 10 and grade 12 went on maternity leave because she adopted a child from a student. And the new teacher was brand new out of university and said I was lying to her, making things up. And I'm like, no, I got these accommodations put in place under the old teacher. Did she not tell you? And I got frustrated and said, there's no point in me doing this. I'm done. I'm not going to argue with people. And so if I knew what I knew today, how to advocate for myself, I would have advocated for myself back then, but I didn't know how to do that. And so it's really hard. And so to tie this back into employment, it's knowing our rights and what we can ask for accommodations and finding the right employers. And sometimes finding the right employers doesn't work because we have such unique things. So self-employment for the intellectual disability is not even looked at as a viable whole thing. They're like, we're going to find you a placement. Like Inclusion Alberta and Inclusion Lethbridge is like, you have to find a placement and you have to do it this way. And I'm like, that's not the way I want to do it. Sorry.
Yeah.
It's like you're being pigeonholed into this. You have to do it a certain way.
Plus, when you are working for yourself and you're on something like AISH or any other, you know, support program, once you start making any money, they start clawing back your benefits right away. And so there's just not a lot of incentive to try and take care of yourself.
Exactly. And those benefits are the most important thing, because when you're self-employed, you don't get benefits. It's not like working for a big corporation that can offer benefits.
That's right. So
it's a catch-22.
Yeah. And for us, now that I have disabilities and everybody in my family is neurodivergent, like all of our children, my spouse, me. And so we need benefits, but because I'm self-employed, I don't have an employer benefit program. We have to pay out of pocket for our extended health benefits. And it's expensive. Like it's like $300 a month.
And again, how can somebody afford that when most of my age goes to living now just to rent a place?
Exactly.
Now I'm lucky I live with my dad, because when my mom's health started going downhill, I moved in to help with her. And my dad has let me stay and live with him. And it's beneficial because I'm helping him fix up the place and stuff. So it's beneficial for both of us. But to be forced into having to do that, though, to survive. Yeah.
Right.
Is not right.
And the entire point is to try and make people with disabilities have as much independence and autonomy as possible. But if you have to move back into your parents in order to be able to survive.
It's not surviving in a lot of ways. And so for me, it's like, I think coming on this podcast is important to share my story with people, because people don't understand disabilities to the fullest. When you have support of a parent that can afford to buy a house and put it in your name, and you get rent off that place if you have to live within a group home, I don't have anything like that.
Right.
And so it gets frustrating when you hear all these stories of people getting supported by parents that have this income for their son or daughter. And my parents wish they were able to do that, but couldn't. It's one of those real struggles. And I think talking about these openly with total strangers on the street is important, so they hear these stories. However, I can reach out and stuff to tell this story is very important to me. So thank you for letting me be on the podcast.
Oh yeah, I'm happy to have you on here. Another thing I was thinking of too is like, it can be a challenge for people with disabilities to, even though self-employment is, you know, one of the only options they have in order to have an income, it can be a challenge because it's difficult to be able to run your own business for the same reason it's difficult to hold down a steady full-time job, right? The same challenges you have in holding down a job are still there when you're trying to run your own business. And so, you know, trying to bring in enough clients and trying to be able to have enough work coming in can also be challenging. And so it'd be nice if the system was set up to be able to help people succeed. It just isn't.
Exactly. And how can we advocate if the general public doesn't know the issues? Because you need them on board, because they are helping pay for these programs that PDD and AISH offer. And so you want them to be on board. I do a lot of volunteering and giving back to the community. And I probably give back more than some of these philanthropists that have a lot of money that'll pay for the YMCA to be built and stuff. I probably give more back in volunteer hours than they do in cash. And so it's like people don't realize that or don't recognize that as giving back sometimes. Like people on AISH aren't just on AISH to become problems and be addicts or whatever.
Exactly.
I was told by a business owner that I got to know a little bit and as a friend, and we were talking about tiny homes because I want to build one eventually and figured that out. Part of the conversation was she was out in Stirling and she was on the town council out there, and she was talking about how they decide not to have a tiny community like a trailer park or anything like that because it will bring riffraff.
Oh my goodness.
I looked at her and I said, I live in a trailer park right now. I want to build a tiny home. You're calling me riffraff. And the look on her face because of how much money I put into her business was like, oh, I shouldn't have said that. But to be honest, not everyone that lives in a trailer park is riffraff. And so the stigma, if I'm not brave enough to speak up for this, how are people like her going to change their minds?
Sure.
And so I'm brave enough to be like, I know she didn't mean to attack me personally, but she is. And so let's have this conversation so she can realize that that's not true.
Sure. Yeah. And you can be riffraff and be in a single detached dwelling. Like you don't have to be in a trailer park to be able to be riffraff.
Exactly. The tiny home movement is something that's so great because it's changing people's opinions about how we have to live as a society. We don't need Absolutely. A big home. Like, come on. And it shouldn't devalue those bigger homes that a tiny home is in between. Like, come on.
And how many people in Sterling have an RV or a fifth wheel?
Exactly. And that's considered a tiny home on wheels.
That's right.
People do live out of their RVs full time.
Yeah.
There's a lot of YouTube channels again. It's hilarious that these mindsets that are set in one way of looking at low-income people. And I do give back to the industry. Like, I spend money. I buy laptops. I put money back into the economy as well. People need to realize that when we're talking about programs to help people, it's helping everybody in society.
Exactly.
The rich and the in-betweens as well.
Yeah, people who are on assistance programs are also job creators because they're spending their money. Every time they spend money, it increases demand. And increased demand is the number one cause for job creation.
Exactly. But we're looked at as riffraff or just people that want to go and get drunk or want to spend money on alcohol and drugs. It's not true.
Right.
There might be 1% of us on age that do that.
Oh, you mean like the general population?
Exactly.
I think you mentioned earlier that you have a brother.
Yes.
Just the one sibling?
Yeah.
Okay. And is he older brother?
Older, yeah.
All right. What's he up to?
So both me and him have disabilities, so.
Okay. So he's kind of in the same boat as you, just trying to make things work or whatever. And he does a bunch of advocacy work, doesn't he?
Yes. Yeah. And he wants to go back to school as well, so.
Oh, okay. Cool.
Yeah.
Does he know what program he wants to go into?
The teacher's aid program at the college here.
Oh, neat. So, okay, that's cool.
Yeah.
All right. And so now you're where you are now.
Yep, pretty much.
Awesome. Great. So a question I ask all of my guests is, how has your intersections of marginalization ever influenced your experiences as a worker? And that could be everything from gender to orientation, disability, ethnicity, religion, economic class, whatever.
I think it's the disability piece is the big one for me. And it comes down to like the one job at Telegraph where she wanted to protect me, but protecting me did more harm than having it be productive. Because when you move from one employer to another, I have a choice of disclosing that disability or not. And so when they sold the business, she's trying to protect me and say, you need to keep him because he has a disability. And I'm like, no, unlike any other worker, if I don't fit what he wants, he has every right to let me go. And so when she said that to him, I was like, no, you can't do that because you have no right to disclose my disability to anybody unless it affects the work and stuff. And so that intersectionality of the disability and the moving from one job to another or the business being sold, it was awkward. And it's something that I, to this day, feel uncomfortable with because I never told her. And people are like, well, you shouldn't tell her. And some are like, maybe you should. And that there's that back and forth. But if I don't ever tell her, how can she learn?
Right. Yeah, absolutely.
And so I think people are afraid of creating controversy amongst people with disabilities and people that hired you. And I'm like, so, yeah.
I mean, I can see why it would make you uncomfortable. I mean, sort of infantilizing you, right?
Yes.
By just saying, hey, give him special treatment because, you know, he needs it or whatever. And not realize you're an individual person with your own autonomy and you can take care of yourself.
Exactly. And that intersectionality of, I don't think you always need to disclose as well. And I think in a lot of cases, it was good to disclose because the way I got the job is he kept offering me work and I kept turning him down. And so I'm like, I'll try serving, but if I don't like it, I want to be a dishwasher / prep cook.
Right.
He wanted me to bartend and all that. And so there's that. I don't even know if this is answering your question, to be honest, because it's that intersectionality of disability and wanting to be part of the crew. How do you work with an employer like that? Like, I don't have a job coach or anything. I never have. I've always found my own jobs or and stuff. So, yeah.
Cool. All right. Any final thoughts for our listeners?
Just thank you for letting me be on here. And if you want to know more information, there's People First of Canada and People First of Alberta. So yeah, look those up.
Yeah, I'll put the links to them into the description.
Awesome. Thank you.
And if people want to follow you or any, do you have any public social media accounts or websites or anything?
My Facebook is public.
Okay.
So you can follow me there.
All right.
So
cool.
Yeah,
I'll put a link to that in the description as well.
Thank you.
And if people want to follow the Alberta Worker, you can find us on social media. We're on Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn. And you could also check out our website, albertaworker.ca. While you're there, you might as well sign up for our email newsletter. We send out an issue every day, once a week and once a month. If you liked this episode and the conversation that we had with Chris, please rate and review our podcast. If you want to support the Alberta Worker, please go to albertaworker.ca/support. The Alberta Worker and this podcast depend on the financial support of valuable listeners just like you. If you want to be a guest on the Alberta Worker, just send us an email at podcast@albertaworker.ca or send us a DM on one of our social media accounts. Thanks so much, Chris, for joining us today. Thanks so much to all the listeners. As always, solidarity.